All right, how's everyone doing? So welcome to our week.
Microphone.
Yeah, look at the only thing. I mean, it's almost working.
Okay, try now. All right, good. All right. Sorry. All right. So if you're online. Okay. If you're online, please raise your hand or post your question to the chat and I will read it for you. So we're gonna go ahead and get started. Our presenter is Joel Brandon from General Electric down in Wilmington. Joel is a mechanical and nuclear systems engineer with GE. He completed his mechanical and engineering undergrad at NCAMT and then received his master's degree in our department, nuclear engineering at NC State in 2020, where he studied secondary electron emission on surfaces by a metastable atom interaction. And that's what we're in the plasma lab. And then he decided, well, plasmas. And so during that time, he decided to pursue his love for fluid and thermodynamics. I guess he was sick of fluids that responded to electromagnetic fields and decided to try something easier. And clean energy production that drove him to, that initially motivated his move to graduate studies. So since leaving NC State, he has been doing thermohydraulic modeling and analysis on passive heat removal systems for the Natrium reactor, as well as providing system design for the intermediate heat transfer loop and primary sodium processing systems for ARC Canada. So with that, I give you our today's speaker and one of my very good friends, Joel Brandt.
Well, thank you.
Again, my name's Joel. I'm talking about this is going to be about passive reactor cooling, the modeling that I've done. It's not going to include much on somebody's seen to present his view upon this timeline. So this is not going to include any of the other systems engineering that I've done, like the sodium processing system or the intermediate heat transfer system, because I mean, that's been more systems engineering, hasn't been analytical or modeling. So that's what we are focusing on for this presentation.
Yeah. I think that should be good. All right. Sorry about that. Get this out of your way. All right. Sorry.
And so for that, we'll just kind of move on into it.
You probably got to click on the.
So the overview, we're going to give us brief discussion on what passive reactor cooling is and just kind of natural air circulation. We'll get into the MATLAB modeling that I've done. I've also done some modeling in the Dimola-Modelica systems language, which is the Modelica language and the Dimola-Modelica systems modeling software. It's a really cool software that it allows much easier systems integration. And then we'll talk about some of the ongoing work with it. So this is a picture of the Natrium reactor plant in. You see these stacks right here? I'm sorry, this is the Natrium's prism. I don't think I'm allowed to show you the Natrium. So we've got stacks right here up and down. At this point, we've got hot air exit, cold air intake. And then the rest of the passive system is actually going to come down and around here. And I'll show you that a little bit more on that in a moment. But so this is
This comes from the stack effect. And so the stack effect can actually work two different ways. It can cause air to heat up in a building or in some entity, and it can cause air to cool down in it. And really, the movement of the air up or down is really going to depend on whether or not you're cooling or you're heating it. In our case, we're not worried about cooling the air. We're using the air to cool the reactor. So we only really need to care about one part of it. And so this natural phenomena is driven by a difference in buoyancy in the air. As you heat up the air, it becomes less dense and it wants to rise. And through that action, it essentially creates a pump for you. And so this can drive airflow up or down. It's the main reason for smoke movement through high-rise buildings. There's a lot of study on it, a lot of knowledge with it. It's a completely passive system. It doesn't involve any pumps, any dampers, anything like that. You can have stuff like that in the system. None of it is actually required, though. And so this is a better picture on what the actual system will be. So you have cold air coming in here, but again, everything is really driven by this spot right here going up the reactor. You can see right here as heat, if air is coming along the reactor, it heats up and dries up. And it creates a pretty much vacuum that's pulling your cold air in and it pushes your hot air out. And so you have this type of an airflow through it. It comes down around this baffle or this wall, different on different reactors. And then it heats up, drives up, and out your exit stacks. And so this is completely natural convection again. There's zero moving parts. This isn't something a person needs to initiate or stop or anything like that. There's electrical components in it, but these are only really for monitoring. There's, again, nothing to actually drive it. It just does it itself. Parasitic heat removal on it is a concern, but with that, we're only really dealing with 0.5% of reactor rated thermal power. I actually think it's closer to 0.25%. A little bit about Gen 4 reactors real quick. They are inherently safe. They're much safer than some of the older reactors that we've had. They're safer designs and fuel. They're using sodium as a coolant instead of water. And that's a big plus to these reactors. From what I understand, I haven't done these experiments myself, but they've tried to basically melt down these types of reactors and they failed. The reactor shuts itself down because it hits a self-limiting reaction and then it starts to slow down and it stops. So no Fukushima, no Three Mile Island, no Chernobyl with these. So that's a awesome part about these. But if you lose the cooling systems, you can still destroy your reactor. So if that happens 10 years into the 60-year reactor life, you're out a lot of money. It's nice that this is governed by the laws of nature, again, rather than human intervention. One thing this does is it kind of helps protect the concrete structure during normal operation. You got to keep that to a certain temperature. That's actually mainly covered through insulation, though. So you can really increase the insulation as much as you need to protect the concrete. So the real action behind this modeling is to prevent excessive damage to the core of the reactor in the event of a shutdown. So what are we modeling? This is not an exhaustive list of what we're modeling, but we're modeling the air mass flow through all of our airflow nodes. So frictional losses, density changes, driving the natural circulation, temperature movement throughout all the nodes. There's something in here that says we have about 1,000 nodes. We've dropped that down quite a bit. Steady state heat removal, long-term transient heat removal, so 55 hours or more. We're mainly concerned with component temperature peaks and then like time at certain temperatures so we can deal with creep fatigue and any issues that arise from that. And so to get into the MATLAB modeling side that we are doing, it's the program we're using. It's a wide set of maybe 20 or so MATLAB functions. There's about 6 that we use that I flow through on a regular basis that I keep up with MATLAB. The rest are just kind of called throughout the process. Again, as this says 1,000+ nodes, since I made this, we've been able to drop it down to actually less than 500 nodes, which has helped this whole part quite a bit, the simulation time. It's an airflow and heat transfer solver, 1D fluid flow, 2D heat transfer. No, this is not necessary. Development since at least 2017. It's a steady state and a transient solver. And we've been able to actually get this 1-to-1 translation down to about 3-to-1. So that's been nice. Able to do long-term transients in the term of time of a day instead of having to go over 3 full days for it. So this is a lump parameter modeling system where we have a node here, we've got a node there, and we have some conduct conductance between them. That conductance is determined by a number of heat transfer equations. It could be radiation, conduction, convection. And so the idea is to get all of these equations right around the simple term. We have G, which is our conductance, the inverse of the resistance. And so this is going to be our general term for all of our heat transfer. That's what that allows us to simplify the analysis quite a bit. And so everything, you'll show that in a minute. We turn everything into that G, and then we can basically look at a simple delta T and the energy in and out of any given node. This is extremely complicated. This is the nodalization of our system. It's a lot to look at. The color differences in that little table up there kind of tells us what it is, but we have airflow coming in through here, comes down our downcomer, goes through some orifices on the bottom, comes up. This is where it gets heated and where our all of our driving, the air movement comes from and comes out, it expels to the atmosphere. And then we have heat flowing from our cold pool. Steady state, we just hold these walls at a specific temperature of the cold pool and we determine the steady state from that. In the transient, we have to open that up. And then we have heat generation that actually happens in the hot pool. Hot pool flows to the cold pool through the primary or through the heat exchangers. And so we have energy exchange between the hot and cold pool that way. And then we have energy exchange between the cold pool and the rest of the system through conduction through the reactor vessel, radiation, convection, conduction through any other parts, radiation across this gap, and then convection from both this side and that side to the air flowing through it. All this part here circled in red is actually part of the reactor enclosure system, but it's all still a very important part of the rack modeling. So one thing we have to do in order to get the rack modeling is develop some of a reactor model. It's not nearly as complicated as it could be. We are not modeling the core. We're basically talking about a certain amount of energy density or energy deposition that's coming from the core every time step. And so this is our governing heat transfer equation. The change in temperature with time is equal to the 1/(capacitance) times, you know, internal energy generation, conduction or convection heat transfer, and then radiation transfer as well. That's too early. All right. So like I said, we want to get everything to have this common G term. So with conduction and convection, that's quite simple. Ka over L or HA, those just become our G term. So we solve for that. And then we're dealing with a temperature difference and the temperature difference between convection. Radiation is a little bit more complicated, but everything factors out fairly nicely to give us this term here that comes out to be our G and goes into our nodalization scheme to solve numerically for what our temperature is. I'm going to try not to bog you down with a whole bunch of equations. This is a modeling paper, so there's going to be in there, but again, we know that's not fun, so I'm going to try and give it to you in a different type of a manner. We're dealing with steady state, so we're starting with steady state. And so with that, we get to ignore 1/(capacitance) and we get to ignore the time rate of change. And so now everything here is equal to zero. And so we're able to actually solve for the nodal temperature on a numerical basis using this equation with everything simplified a little bit, where we're basically dealing with that G, and it, also in steady state, we're not dealing with any heat addition either. So we have our G times delta T basically equals zero. So we solve that for every node. Once we have a temperature change that's acceptable, roughly 0.02 Kelvin, it kind of dances around that spot. So once we have that, then we consider a steady state and then we can go ahead and move on. Our transient solver comes directly from the steady state. So once we solve for steady state conditions, we can move over into the transient and start that and see what happens where now these two terms come into play again. This one is actually a fairly important term that requires us to have more of that reactor model. So having accurate sodium models, having accurate weights, having accurate weights for, you know, machinery within the reactor, any metals in there as well, all those contribute to the capacitance and the thermal battery that is your reactor. And all of this stuff contributes to how fast your sodium heats up or doesn't heat up. In our case, we want it to reach its peak but come back down. And so whether that's fast or slow, that's not quite as relevant. The height of that peak is what's mostly relevant. So we have our material properties, most of which are a function of temperature, our heat capacity, you know, density, specific heat. And so we do solve for those in each iteration of this as we're moving forward. This is an explicit Euler approximation, so it's a forward difference method. We have stability issues once in a while. It's a lot more straightforward than other other options. But again, we do have stability issues if we have too large of a delta T, but that's rather simple. We just restrict our time step, and that allows us to keep our stability in check so that we are able to actually finish it instead of everything kind of going haywire and having temperature changes of 1,000 and 1/4 seconds. Again, more stability requires a much more iterative approach, adding time and complexity to the model. This is the structure of the model that was created in 2017. So that's what we have moved forward with. This is the base equation for the mass flow. We are using an equation that many of us are familiar with, the Bernoulli equation. And we're taking actually here and solving for a pressure difference between two points. So if you take a stack and move over to infinity, and you take an exit stack, or I guess that was an exit stack, if you take an intake stack and move over to infinity, you have basically this equation here where the two pressures are equal to some average density times gravity times the delta Z in there. And so we solve both of these equations, set them equal to each other, and we're able to solve for mass flow based on density change. The density change with some friction added, and the acceleration loss due to energy loss due to acceleration as well. So that's the equation that we're using every iteration to solve for our mass flow, both steady state and in our transient. I will talk why in a minute about why that's applicable in our transient. So the overall process of this solver goes, you know, we take our guess for our mass flow and temperatures, we iterate, and then we calculate mass flow with the Bernoulli equation, calculate new temperatures, solve or stop when we have a delta T that we accept. In the transient solver, you load the steady state data, calculate a new mass flow, calculate the decay heat. We have our internal volume generation, our internal heat generation in the hot pool. Calculate our heat flow, calculate new temps, and just repeat and repeat and repeat. It's a fairly simple process once it gets going. MATLAB modeling, as everyone knows, the longest part about it is probably trying to figure out where you put that random S or period in on accident. Why do we believe that we can use the Bernoulli's equation in the transient? Because we are essentially in a quasi-steady state situation where Bernoulli's equation assumes steady state. Well, the mass flow change in between any given time step, we're dealing with about 10 to the minus 5, so in kilograms per second. So we are in any subsequent iterations within that time step. So we've done this where we just have, you know, we just do it per time step, but also we go to iterations within any time step to see how much more the mass flow changes. And then the second iteration in there goes to 10 to the minus 8. So we are in what we would argue is a quasi-steady state situation because our mass flow is, for any given time step, because this is such a slow-moving system and our time steps are about 1/4 of a second or 0.2 seconds. So for any given time step, our mass flow is essentially constant and we have very little changes. And when we do have changes in things like Reynolds number, for instance, we are solving for those K values and fittings based on the Reynolds number. So we are taking into account any actual changes when we get to there. Some of the results that we've gotten out of it, I really like heat maps. So I've got a couple of these in there. I just like how they look. I feel like they're very effective visually in understanding what's going on and seeing how the temperature gradient changes throughout your system. Most of this is unfortunately on a small scale compared to the reactor here. And so you don't see much change over here, but this is some of the more important stuff to us, the temperature inside the insulation and the pedestal. It's not quite as relevant to monitor. So these are some of the results that we have in our transient simulation. You see our maximum hot pool temperature here is, I think, about 1040. We have 1040 Fahrenheit. That's one thing. If you ask me what I don't like about industry, it's that we deal with English units instead of being able to deal with metric. I solve everything in metric units and just have to convert so everybody likes to. But yeah, metric is where it's at. But so 1040 Fahrenheit, we have limits of roughly, I think it's like 1157 and 1200 for the fuel before we have to analyze to see if we have any damage in our fuel. But as of As of right now, the way we are modeling everything and the way we're viewing everything, the rack system is behaving properly, and it is working to the common goal of everything. Now you guys have a senior project that is going to study a little bit about our rack system and the emissivity, which is a huge driver of the actual heat that comes out of it. So I'm not sure if I see anybody from that project in here, but they're going to be looking into the emissivity and how any emissivity coatings can actually affect the rack performance, which that's the biggest driver for rack performances. We need a high emissivity on the reactor vessel and the guard vessel, because that's really our choke point. If we can't get the heat out of the reactor vessel, it's irrelevant that we have air going through it. And so some of the heat balance that we have, we see that, you know, we've got our decay heat. This is a model of the decay heat calculated, and this is a model or a graph of the heat removed by the air. You can see that they cross each other. What's that, about 27 hours? If we go back one slide, we see that our max came right here, I don't know, roughly 25 hours. So the max temperature actually comes a little bit before your decay heat and the heat removed by the air cross, but that's because there's all these other pieces that are still heating up. They're taking energy from the hot and cold pool. They're still heating up at that time and still demanding some of that energy as well. Some of the work that we've done, I'll talk about later. We have a lot of optimization efforts. At this point, we're trying to do different things that we can to save money. One of those things we've done is taken the downcomer section. So outside of the reactor, the cylinder that is equal in height to the reactor, air is coming down, and then it's got to come underneath and go up a channel so that it gets heated by the reactor. That channel was about 4 feet wide on the way down. We've minimized that to about 10 inches because you can see that there's really no change from going from a meter down to, you know, roughly 0.25 meters. That's the point that we chose to stick with for the gap so that we weren't dropping off and adding too much friction. There's minimal loss in cooling with this decision, and it's going to save a lot of in excavation costs. That's about 8 feet in diameter when you're talking about moving from roughly 70 feet diameter to 62 feet or so. So a lot of money savings in that excavation cost there. One thing I really like to do is kind of like sanity checks with it is just to watch what's happening. So I generally like to visualize things in time. And so this is the movement from that earlier plot of what happens when we get into the transient and how we see the heat flow out, how it, you can see the change and how it basically, it comes out and it goes through to the riser section here. You're not gonna see much of a change in here. This is all still gonna be purple just because of the scale that we have here. But these are types of things that I like to look at, especially when modeling, to give myself a sanity check to make sure heat's at least moving in the right direction. So different bits of functionality that we've wanted to add include what happens if the reactor vessel gets a crack and we leak sodium out into the guard vessel, and now this argon gap instead fills up with sodium. Well, what happens with that is that we get much more efficient heat transfer. This is not really a rack problem. It's definitely an RES problem and a containment problem. But as far as the reactor air cooling system is concerned, it gets put on steroids right here pretty much. It's a huge power boost because now you've got this heating up the guard vessel, the sodium heating up the guard vessel, as opposed to requiring the radiation. So instead of the 100 to 150 delta T across these due to the radiation in the argon layer, now we have an extremely hot guard vessel, so the reactor heat removal is highly increased. What happens if we have a tornado come in and it throws a car into our stacks, and now we have only this pair of stacks operating versus this pair of stacks? So that's part of the design of it. We do have we're able to take it down to one stack, pair, two stacks, doesn't matter. We do still have sufficient energy removal if we are down to two stacks. So that's, again, that's part of the design, is to add redundancies to make sure that we can lose things and it still works. Because this is a safety related system. Really important as that, in order to get it passed as a safety related system, it's got to perform in a lot of areas. It's got to perform in its normal state. It's got to perform in an expected shutdown and then also unexpected shutdown times. And so these are really the most important parameters that we're having to deal with, that essentially can be variables within the program. The decay heat for the transient is the most important. That's where, that's really the profile that everything is going to follow. It's going to be determined by the decay heat coming out of the fuel. Sodium mass, solid metal mass, material properties. These two I mentioned before, they're basically thermal batteries. The more the sodium weighs, the more machinery you have in there, the lid, the size of the reactor vessel, all of these soak up energy as the fuel is depositing its decay heat. So as all these soak up energy and they hold on to it, they are slowing down the temperature rise of the sodium. So these are the most things that are the most important really in the transient. These pieces become more important really with all of them, you know, the sodium temperature profiles. We found that we have a normal sodium temperature profile gradient up the reactor vessel that by applying that in our modeling, we increase heat transfer by about 25%. Emissivity, I mentioned earlier, you guys have a senior project that will be covering the effects of irradiation on different emissivity layers. Flow friction and fittings and surface roughness, these things are less impactful because as you generally in the natural circulation system, as you slow the flow down, it has a longer residence time. So it is able to kind of hold on to, or it heats up a little bit more. It doesn't necessarily remove more heat total, but is able to heat up a little bit more. And it's able to kind of keep up with that that balance if you slow the flow down. From things that I've seen, this is how I feel after about a day, is I'm looking at that and I don't know what's going on. I look at words that like cold that make sense to me, but just don't anymore. Like when you're doing coding and you start looking at three and four letter words, you're like, is that right? You've looked at it a little bit too long. So that's kind of the limitations with MATLAB, is that visualization aspect, you're just working with coding. Also with our, with the method we're moving forward with it, we have our time step, which is pretty much governed by this equation here, the node capacitance divided by the sum of that G term and the delta T's. And that determines what our time step can be. So that is a limitation, so we also have, you know, time. Back when we made this, it was, again, a one-to-one time. If you wanted a 70-hour transient, you needed to run it for 70 hours. Now it's roughly 25 or so. Stability and debugging are not exactly fun, although debugging this, I think, is actually easier than like the Dymola modeling we're about to talk about. Okay, so Dymola Modelica systems modeling. I believe Modelica is the language. Dymola, I believe, is the name of the program. It's all brought by, I think, Dassault Systems, but it's a multi-physics systems modeling. It's got fluid physics built into it, thermodynamics, it's electrical. There is a nuclear kinetic solver built into it. This transform library actually was created by people at Oak Ridge National Labs. And so these are other libraries that we've had implemented into this. And so it's constantly being built by, PhDs and people that have been working on this for their life, or I guess not their life in this case, but have been working on this for their career. And so the libraries that are going into this are constantly being updated with not necessarily new physics, but taking physics and applying it in new ways to different fields, whether it's chemistry or, again, fluids, electrical, heat and mass transfer. They got a lot of nice examples in there. So this one helped us out a lot when we were wanting to build it. This is just a simple example that the people at Oak Ridge built into this transform library that has a model of the natural circulation of the system. And their models are plug and play and ready to go. And a big part of it, you can actually copy and paste things out of those models, put it into another model, which we're going to talk about in a minute, because the working in Dymola is exceptionally easy, especially compared to building something in MATLAB. This is a pretty much a picture of one of the RVAC system that we built in the Dymola model. This was not exactly the same rack system. It's similar, but for a different reactor. This was done for Ashimi in Japan for the PRISM reactor. So geometry and some of the things in it are a little bit different, but same type of deal. This was built, about 80% of it was built in a day. So it's the MATLAB program that took about 5 years for numerous people to build and add on to get us to where we are today. We got almost all of that in a day messing with the software, because it's mostly plug and play. It follows its own momentum and energy balance equations. And anytime you bring in something like a pipe or a boundary condition or this RV right here, this thermal mass, and every time you bring something like that into this object diagram, it brings in all of the code with it. So you don't have to do a whole lot of coding and looking through this. It's very visual, similar to Simulink. It's really nice to work with. You click on one of these, you find the variables that you can mess with, input those. If you really need to change something, you can go into the source code and do as you please with it. If you break it, you break it. You can always go back and pull in something that did work or find other examples that allow you to work with it. You can kind of design the codes really how you want. So it's a mixture of being able to have the open source of MATLAB, but not requiring the open source of MATLAB, where you can do things without having to know what 100 lines of code you're going to put in. It's exceptionally user-friendly with integration. If I build this model and we have our rack system and we want to integrate it with a reactor enclosure system, we want to know what is happening. So we have our boundary conditions and it's basically a temperature boundary that we're putting at the reactor vessel. But say somebody builds a reactor systems model, we can get rid of our reactor portion here and then just essentially have a connector that goes out of this diagram here to this outer diagram and allows us to plug in a reactor model. And so it's a really plug and play. As long as this is, there's going to have to be some design work to make sure that this output equals the input that this wants. But again, very plug and play allows us to do fully like plant integrated systems analysis. So we have a systems integration team that is kind of studying the reactor model with this RVAX model, with another passive plant cooling model, with, you know, the intermediate heat transport system. This allows us to take all of it and put it together without being anywhere near as computationally expensive as MATLAB or something like RELAB. Similar to what we just showed earlier, multi-layer block diagrams, you know, this diagram right here opens up to our model of what's happening in the reactor. And then maybe this block diagram right here would open up to show all of our fluid models for the ducting and everything coming in. And we've got our pressure boundary layers that we can set to whichever pressure and temperature that we deem necessary. And so the code, it kind of, again, it comes with the block. All of this right here that you see is all within that part. But for instance, this riser one, so we put one pipe into the riser right here, and the system imported all of this code. And this red piece here, each of these red pieces is the flow model for the pipe, the geometry for the pipe, and the heat transfer model for the pipe. And so each of these can open up another basically function, another 100 lines of code that are all getting put into this that it's definitely helpful to know and understand what you're looking at, but developed by people that have been working on these types of things. And so it does limit the amount of time that you spend in front of a computer coding on it. Data reporting on this isn't as attractive as MATLAB. It's pretty much graphs and tables. That's really what we see. This is a chart of our riser temperature on the input and the exit. So it catches up to steady state pretty quick. This is only capable of, its steady state solver just solves over time. But it reaches its steady state and temperature, you know, very fast. It reaches it within about 100 seconds or so. You know, heat flow further out might take a little bit longer to reach that. But again, mainly tables and graphs. I personally don't know how to get anything prettier out of it, but other people may. So we've done some different comparisons with it. If we apply a pressure difference between the input and output that is roughly equal to the height difference between the inlet and outlet stacks, we see that we have about a 15% difference in the air mass flow rate. But what we also see is that our heat removed is still relatively similar. If we get rid of that same pressure difference, that brings our mass flow difference down to about 8%. And you can see there was not much of a move on the heat removed from it. So roughly 8% change in the mass flow rate and about 3% change in the heat removal. That is kind of the benefit of that passive reactor system. We are still working on updating and developing the Dymaloff model. Again, I made this Dymaloff model in about a day. So it's not exactly the most extensive, and there's definitely some work that can be done to make it a little bit more extensive to compare with MATLAB. But we do have somebody else working on an alternate calculation for that at the moment. The limitations that we have exist with the Daimler model, initialization, zero crossings, somewhat visualization as far as, how the data output and how that looks. And it is a 1D fluid solver. It's not a CFD solver or anything like that. It's not going to tell you, it's not going to help you with turbulence or any eddies or anything like that in your flow. Zero crossings are a pain. It's every time I've had to do a zero crossing when we've tried to study what happens if a hurricane comes in and the pressure differential between those stacks changes. Do you get reverse flow? This basically showed us, yes, we do get some reverse flow, but it can't do anything about it because when we start to reverse flow, it freaks out. So some of the ongoing work that we actually have regarding the modeling for this system, it's in industry, you're affected a lot more by other systems rather than in graduate school. Everything you're doing is kind of based on your studies and everything like that. Whereas we completely make this model and then somebody else decides that the pedestal geometry changes. So now we got to take this model and get rid of all that and do something else. Or somebody says the ducting geometry is changing, or we're changing the size of the reactor. And so that entirely changes the model, and we're constantly reiterating on this process to answer the questions basically as to what happens if we do change these things. Going through constant optimization efforts, you saw earlier we went through that annulus sizing where we dropped it from 4 feet to 10 inches. We've asked to have optimization efforts for duct sizing and emissivity. That's the main driver right here. I don't really want to tell anybody what minimum duct sizing we can have until we figure out that emissivity question, because if that changes, then everything else is going to change. The emissivity is what drives it. If we find out that we can't have these coatings that give us 0.7, then we're going to need much larger ducts, and everything else is going to change. So people have been pressuring me quite a bit to give them answers for this optimal duct sizing and how low we can go. And my answer is pretty much every time, well, that depends. And that's because it really depends on that emissivity question and what actually comes out of it. Some of the insights I had from modeling this, I mentioned earlier, no, 2D heat transfer is not needed. It was much faster to cut it out because we got rid of, I think, 30 to 40% of those G calculations, the heat transfer calculation. And what we were really looking at is that G value and comparing that value. And so through the cylinder, radially outward, we were dealing with a G value of on the order of 10 to the 4 and 10 to the 5. Along the axis, it was about 8, not 10 to the 8, but 8. And so it was computationally expensive and really not necessary. It wasn't going to change our answers and our simulation very much by including that. So we were able to take it out and save a lot of time with that. Another thing we did, we actually did kind of take a lot of this out. So some of those changes that happened from that reactor pedestal that I mentioned here, some of those changes actually came in and helped out our computational efforts quite a bit, because we went from more than 1,000 nodes down to less than 500. And so between that and getting rid of the 2D heat transfer, now again, a 70-hour simulation takes about 20 to 24 hours to run. Another thing we've done is that this is extremely long simulation, so the amount of data that you record is huge. If we were recording every time step and all of the data that was coming out of it, we could only run one simulation at a time. It was too much memory required on the computer, and it kept crashing if I tried to run a second simulation. Well, if we only record 1% of the data, and so now we take 100 time steps before we record anything, and we just go ahead and do that again and again and again, now I can run 3 simulations at once. So I can do a lot more with that as opposed to just waiting 2 days to run a simulation, 2 days to do another one. It's also nice to have a system to move variables forward use in other functions instead of in the case, like all of these were just numbers. Like, so the air supply was node 700. So if I change anything in this area where now these node numbers change and now I have to go through all of the functions to go and change what my node number is for the air supply, that was a huge pain. So have a system to move actual variables forward through your different functions and be able to reference those variables in a way that prevents you from having to change them anytime you make a smaller change. some of those ongoing efforts that we're doing, the situational simulations, adjustments for, again, new geometry, the ongoing work in Dymola models for alternate calculations, and the whole plant model that we have going on again. So there's, I can't be a part of this. In order for that alternate calculation to work, I have to be completely separate from it. So the model that I've already developed for it, we can't use it, but again, it took a day to do. So that's the, that was a huge benefit actually, that Dymola Modelica software, is that again, it comes pretty much ready to plug and play, and it's easy to just put things together and take what took 5 years in MATLAB and do it in one day in Dymola. And that concludes the talk, references, and thank you for your attention. And
okay, so we started with the in-house questions. Questions for our speaker.
Is this a steady state problem?
So this was a steady state problem, but when Dymola solves for a steady state, it doesn't do like a numerical integration like the MATLAB one does. This just starts everything, and it starts everything in certain conditions, and it just flows through time. And so in order to find the steady state, you just make sure you have a time frame that's long enough that it's going to get you all your notes to a steady state.
And that's something. Having a state problem.
There are. It's been a while since I talked to them about it. And so some of the tricks were your initial guesses are important. The like initial guess for temperatures, if you are underestimating your temperatures, that's definitely better than overestimating the regulated temperatures. There were a couple of other tricks that we spoke to somebody at Oregon National Labs about that.
Yeah.
We got to meet while you're all thinking of questions. Let me read one from Professor Hayes has a question he posted on the chat. He asks, passive cooling looks like it would drive all preventative measures of ventilation blockage to be safety significant. Can you describe the controls plan to prevent such ventilation blockage?
So to prevent ventilation blockage, we have, the main thing that we have for that is louvers at the intake and exit stacks. And so they are extremely high off the ground. And I'm talking like, I want to say 60 to 70 feet off the ground. So we've got louvers that are designed to prevent rain intrusion. They're small enough sizes that they're going to prevent birds and squirrels and things like that from getting into the stacks as well. The stacks that we're dealing with are about 2 meters in diameter or so. So the blockage in those is not a large expected problem. We have situations like, for instance, the tornado missile or something like that, where we assume that a stack has been entirely knocked out. Beyond that, I'm not entirely sure if I'm able to talk about the security measures that we have if we do have full blockage. If there is full blockage, there are measures, but we are not able to talk about those arguments.
Good answer. More questions from the room?
Is this the ultimate PC? It's the safety related for the reactor operation. So the decay heat jumps to it falls down to about 7% of reactor power within a couple seconds, and then it drops below that. The parasitic heat loss that I was mentioning here basically at normal operation. And so, okay, so that was parasitic. Right, yeah, that was just a parasitic lawsuit. We showed, there was a graph earlier that showed approximately when the air transfer, the heat transfer to the rat air will pass it again. That's about 0.7 hours or so. But there are other systems that are allowed for the decay heat removal, but they are not safe related. So this one being the only safety related in the super form.
You mentioned
it's all on this computer. I wasn't able to connect to the server with it. You got the university cluster here. It got something similar to GE bootcamp on that. So I was limited to computer power and computer memory. And when you've got a matrix of 900,000 by 500, that matters. That's actually when you got two of those running simultaneously, about 60 hours deep and both simulated, and then everything stops out here.
How about the Dimola?
Dimola is it much more friendly. It does solve for all of this data. I don't know about running multiple simulations in the last like our primary data. Simulated, but it's finished in the last year with MATLAB anyway, so it's not quite as needed. For instance, the steady state simulation with MATLAB will take me maybe 3 hours to actually finish the whole steady state, whereas MATLAB was 4 minutes.
Is that a parallel code with Dimola to draw multiple processors?
Connecting to the cluster, talking about.
Think there is a parallel architecture version, but I could be wrong about that.
But even on that, a lot of people have four.
They did go on slow process. Yeah. I don't know if the architecture set up for parallel.
Yeah, I have a question. So, is the passive safety cooling system around the vessel? Matrix very different from X3 and USBWR, or what are the major differences?
I don't know that they have a rack system for X300. I don't know. So that's I haven't done much work on the BWRX. I don't know the exact passive safety system on that, but they don't have this is kind of a first of this kind of thing. There are no other systems that have the passive air cooling like this does, aside from older Prism and BTR, both sodium reactors. And so BWRX has its own passive systems, own passive safety related systems, but they are definitely different from like the rack air cooling.
Yeah, this is not, you don't find this in a light water reactor system.
Is there a reason that you're not using commercial pumps like this and has this?
Yeah.
That is not the design for that. Engineering,
sure. Neither was Excel.
These sorts of things have been done historically in Excel quite a bit. Then they move forward to MATLAB. There are other teams that are simulating this in like RELAP and the safety analysis and SASS, but this allows us to make changes a lot faster than either of those programs. I've had a lot of We've been trying to work a lot to actually compare our results to what comes out of RELAP from this other team. And one of the biggest issues is that I'm able to keep up with the changes that anybody's throwing at me, whether it's the geometry change for the pedestal or the size of the reactor, whereas when you get to RELAP, that's just a headache and it takes days to do. And so they're not able to keep up with the changes as fast as we are with this. So we can get a lot more optimization study and sensitivity studies out of MATLAB than we are able to out of something like RELAP. Any of the commercial software.
Reactor design is still a moving target. Yeah. I mean, there's so many changes going on right now. So, yeah, that's
not probably planning to get an accurate reference because we're always seeing difference, but Dimola had that.
True. And so we had, again, that was a Dimola program that I put together in about a day. So we do have somebody who's working on an alternate calculation to verify these with Dimola. And so that is going to be one of the, so you could license the software, you could get that verified
But we could also do an alternate calculation to show that it is that it is working properly. And so that's what we're doing with Dymola. Somebody else is doing that. Again, I can't have a part of it because I can't be a part of the verification calculation because I have too much effort in this one. So that is happening. And then we're also still comparing results with RELAP and SASIS. And the results are agreeing fairly well with RELAP, with forced flow. We're getting to the point where we understand a lot of the differences. For instance, we have, we're using correlations that came from ANL experimental studies for about 30 years ago. We're using correlations for the Nussel number. And that correlation is a common one. It's a McCarthy-Wolf correlation, but one thing that we have added to it is an entrance effect. So there's a multiplier that goes between 1 and 1.7 or so for the entrance effects. And that's not able to be captured in some of these other programs. Like they have the Nussel number correlation built into it and you can't change it. And so they don't have that entrance effects multiplier. So we found that that's been a big reason why our codes have been disagreeing. And we got back to some bare bones and imposing a lot more boundary conditions like constant reactor temperature, forcing flow and things like that. So not quite allowing the natural circulation. So we've done that so that we can kind of figure out what some of those differences are and why the programs are providing something, providing different numbers. And so now that we've figured that out and where some of that is, we're going to get more to the point of allowing the natural circulation and allowing the solver to do its job while we are keeping some of those boundary conditions more constant, allowing some of the other ones to change again, like, you know, the natural circulation part. We're not going to be forcing flow, we'll be allowing that to happen. So we'll see how the mass flow and the heat will differ more with that. But again, there are other efforts. There's, I want to say, about three other efforts that allow us to compare the results with our MATLAB model and somebody else, but there's that one other effort that is modeling that system in Dymola in order to make this a verified calculation.
Thanks. So, and a related question, since you go that way, would you say, maybe that was answered already, what would be the largest uncertainty sourced from a modeling perspective, such as, you know, kinetic transfer or
the sources of uncertainty are honestly mainly within our reactor model. So this is that's a big part of it because that's just a giant thermal battery. So how that behaves determines, I mean, is as important, I think, in the sodium temperatures as, you know, the airflow coming through the rack. Because, for instance, radiation, if I don't have a very reasonable model for radiation between, you know, the hot pool and the lid, like for, so heat transfer to the lid weighs, I think we're looking at, I don't know, a couple hundred thousand pounds or something like that. I don't know, I think that was kilograms, a couple hundred thousand kilograms in our system. And so if we don't have that accurate, then the amount of energy that's able to absorb, as well as the heat transfer pathways to that. So that's a big part of the uncertainty with this MATLAB model is that reactor model itself, just because of we have to deal with uncertainty in the decay heat. We're adding, I think, 5% is what we've been given right now as a reasonable uncertainty amount for that. But then again, when I put in, for instance, the mass for all the machinery within the reactor, they were unable to tell me what the materials were for all of that machinery. It just hadn't really been defined yet. And so without knowing what metals are in there, and what metals are really making up the core of the fuel and everything like that, it's hard to apply a very accurate thermal capacitance to all these things. And so those are probably, I think, the biggest uncertainties that we have to deal with, is really just based around the reactor model that this all works off of. And yeah, that's one thing about this is it wasn't ever intended to be a reactor model, but once we got into developing the transient for it, we learned how important having all of that information was. And yeah, just even being down to the mass and to be able to get the thermal capacitance of all these pieces as well.
Any questions, more questions from the room? Any more questions from online people? Please raise your hand or start typing faster. I got one. Or give everyone a chance to type for a second. I got one quick question. So at the beginning of the talk, you mentioned meltdowns, mm-hmm. and they're not, they've tried and they can't and everything else. And it was interesting because in the context of a sodium reactor, there's, I don't know if it's the system, is it just sodium reactors in general, or is it systems? Because the one meltdown I remember in the United States was a sodium reactor in Detroit.
It was what?
Fermi one.
Okay. I don't know. And it's been my understanding from people that I guess trusted with this information a little bit higher than me and GE that like there have been experiments with sodium reactors to try and melt them down. Now it could be a combination of that as well as the fuel. And again, from my understanding with the meltdowns, like you can destroy the reactor, but it's not necessarily going to go to a critical point where Fukushima did and just take off, or where Chernobyl did and just take off and keep going, because it will at a point shut itself down. That's my understanding of it.
Okay.
The loss of flow test or whatever it was in the 80s. Yeah. Basically, they cut the pumps off and let it go through sensing.
I thought they had done something like that with sodium too.
Because Fermi one was a loss of flow. It was a piece of a baffle that broken off and basically got stuck in the cooling channels, right? And so lost part of the reactor. But it might be, like you said, it might not be. I don't know what that system looked like compared to the ones you guys are. That was old. That was like in 1956 or something. So. Things just melted in the 50s.
Yeah.
No one cared.
That might have had a little more to do with the fuel and kind of the design of the fuel at that point.
Okay, that gave everyone a chance to type. I don't see any more typing. Any more questions in the room? Going once, going twice. All right, let's thank our speaker one last time.
Thanks. Try.
I'll go ahead and hit stop share and then hit meeting.